Welcome to this lecture. And in this lecture, I'm going to be talking about Korean tradition and how that intersects with K-pop in the context of, particularly the context of music videos. And this is being recorded in early December of 2019, so it will get dated if you're watching it too much after that. First, I'm going to talk about the relationship between K-pop and Korean tradition. So, when we're looking at Korea, these are some things that we need to consider when we consider whether we're seeing tradition in K-pop or not, and what some of the agendas and obstacles might be. One thing is there's a widespread social worry in Korea that young people in particular have lost touch with tradition. And this may drive some artists to want to communicate to their younger audience and to show them something interesting, fascinating, beautiful about their own culture. And at the same time, we know that there are a lot of connections between Korean nationalism, pride in being Korean, the Korean government, and the K-pop industry. Right now, we see that Hallyu is being used to drive tourism to Korea, and the government is heavily invested in tradition-related tourism. I do want to point out, though, that the government isn't making money from this. If you've been to Korea and you've visited something like a government-run museum or a palace, you know that the entry fee, sometimes there's no entry fee, and other times the entry fee is only $1 or $2. And so it's quite affordable. The government's not trying to make a profit from either Koreans or foreigners coming to visit Korea. But they are trying to drive people to be more interested in the history and the rich cultural roots in Korea. So that is part of the larger agenda, and it is part of what makes Korea distinctive from other countries. So if you visit Korea and you visit a palace, particularly if you're not from Asia, you can find that to be fascinating and really interesting and quite different from palaces perhaps in your own country. So and then another issue that we need to think about when we're thinking about having tradition within the context of K-pop is that music making techniques and technology in traditional acoustic music versus the techniques and technology used in K-pop, they don't actually go together very well. And in Korea, there's only a very small population of people who have skills in both traditional music and pop music. And traditional music is it composed on a different scale. The instruments, like I said, are acoustic. It can be very hard to harmonize the sounds in a way that works well. And so part of what ends up happening is that we end up with about three different approaches that are possible. And so one of those approaches is visual connection to tradition within the context of music videos, even if there's no other traditional information within the video. That's pretty easy because you can just pop that into to the music video, or an oral connection to tradition where we're hearing some traditional instruments. There's a few instruments that are being used more commonly. And then a third approach would be when we take tradition and we sort of K-popify it, where we make it a little closer to K-pop, whether it's visually or by adding Western instruments to it. And so I'm going to briefly outline those three different approaches. As you could see from those examples, there was a time period when YG Entertainment in particular was constantly layering in elements of Korean tradition in videos to highlight various fun, exciting aspects of Korea that would make the videos unique and particularly distinctively Korean. However, as you could see in all of those examples, we're not actually hearing a Korean traditional soundscape. What we're doing is just seeing some what to a Korean would be, you know, traditional elements, and what to a foreign audience might be exotic or special elements that they can't find in pop music from their own country. And so I'm just going to type on the screen really quickly so that you can see exactly what those elements were. But speaking it out, in the first video by Big Bang, we see something that's called the Bukchang Saja Nolam. These are actually two lions. I know they didn't look like lions, but they're lion characters from a mass dance drama called Bukchang Saja Nolam. And then in the video Taeyang's Ringalinga, then particularly we're seeing the Songmo, the ribbon hat, the spinning hat. And then in the video by To Anyone, then we're seeing something called Samgo Mu, which is using three different boop drums on a stand and dancing between the three. And I just find it amusing that actually before To Anyone had used Samgo Mu in their video, Shakira had already been using Samgo Mu, except for when Shakira did it, she did very traditional looking drums. And when To Anyone did it, these drums looked very modernized. A few years ago, I was teaching at Korea University, and I had a first year PhD student who did some research looking at using Korean traditional instruments and traditional sounds inside of K-pop. And so she was looking at some songs that were released between 2012 and 2016. And you can just see the names on the screen there. And so she was checking, okay, what kind of genre do they appear in? What kind of instrument appears, and where do they appear? And so I realized that the key part of this is in Korean, but she was looking at how often do we have these different instruments, and she found that Taepyeongso was appearing in three of the different songs. Daegum in two, PD in just one, Gayeogum in five different songs, Haegum in three, Gwinggaeti in five, Jungkook in five, Book in just one, all the Samlenori instruments together in three songs, Minyo appearing in three, and then that she had some Pansori elements. Sasol in one and Chuimse in three. I'm not entirely sure that I would agree with her that Chuimse can be called a Pansori element at all times. But anyway, let's listen to the way that this ended up sounding. And the reason I keep using her PowerPoint, and I'm so grateful to her for letting me use it, is because if you just listen to it, then the instrument and the fact that it's not a Western instrument is much clearer than if you watch it, you get distracted by the visuals. And so I'm very grateful that she extracted these sounds. So this is Taepyeongso, the Korean equivalent of maybe a saxophone. It has a very loud sound. It has a metal bell on the end, and it is a reed instrument. So let's listen to Tierra using Taepyeongso in a hook. And here's Taepyeongso in the intro for Icons, Honestly. And of course, famously, we hear Taepyeongso in Psy's Hangover in the chorus.
Hangover. Hangover.
One of the points that this student was making is that we see Taepyeongso being used more often now because there's now a Taepyeongso plug-in for keyboard. And so this is her playing on the keyboard with the Taepyeongso plug-in to show how you can basically get the same sound that we just heard in Psy's song. Next, we have examples of gayagam. Gayagam is a zither. It's traditionally made with 12 silk strings, but in the modern era, many people have adjusted gayagam and made them with larger numbers of strings, 17, 19, 21, 25 string gayagams made with nylon strings. And in that case, they're often tuned to a Western scale instead of a traditional Korean pentatonic scale. So anyway, here's gayagam being used in the context of K-pop. Tiny G, Nolja. And this is my personal favorite, Song Min-ho and other performers, the song Turtle Ship, Gobuk-sun. And Kim Bum-su, the intro to Noon Will Nanin Ne Sarang. As you could hear, only in this last example are we hearing something that sounds closer to a traditional gayagam. And even that one is obviously with nylon strings, but we have so much electronic adjustment to the instruments. Now, hegam is the two-string fiddle. We can hear hegam in Lucky J's song here.
And
host, damn.
내 말은 네 맘이란 고운 노트를 펼쳐 한 글자 한 글자 핏물처럼 찍어 내려가던 이름 하나 묻자 최선을 다하긴 했어 대답이 없는 의문사 슬픈 표정으로 기억에 불을 붙인다
And Top Dog's arario has many different traditional instruments in it, including haega. Then, of course, we have the large number of songs that include Korean traditional percussion instruments in them. Perhaps I just want to play for you BAP's No Mercy, The Bridge. And part of the reason why this is very interesting is because one of the members, Him Chan, from this group actually had training in Korean traditional percussion music when he went to a specialized high school as a major in traditional percussion. So that's part of the reason why we can hear BAP incorporating traditional percussion more than most other groups do. This is not their only song where they've done that. Son Jung-un, my former student, her final examples related to lyrics. And so we have several different examples here. The first one is G-Dragon. G-Dragon's another person who studied Korean traditional music when he was in school, when he was in high school. And in this one song of his, he both samples and sings lyrics from tradition. So here you can hear the sample first.
G-Dragon, baby!
And then later in the same song, the hook that he uses is from tradition, and it's the same vocal that we just heard right now. And the clear Korean lyrics are written there on the screen. Another example is Kim Hyun Jung. This is the chorus from Unbreakable, and it has very, very stereotypical lyrics that would be used in the context of chuimsae, of encouragement for performers while they're performing to continue their efforts. This is a slightly longer and more complete version of what my student had identified in terms of different songs, which include traditional elements within them, either lyrical or in terms of incorporating traditional instruments. And as you can see, recently it seems that there may be some sort of increase in this as I suppose musicians are becoming more fascinated with some of these Korean traditional sounds and figuring out how to incorporate them. And so this is a trend that you should keep your eye on, and maybe you want to go and listen to some of these specific songs and see if you can pick up those traditional sounds within them. So far, I've talked about how we can see Korean tradition visually within the music video frame. And I've talked about how we can hear Korean traditional sounds sometimes within the actual music. The third thing that I wanted to talk about is the way that some Korean groups are now sort of K-popifying tradition. They're figuring out ways that they can take Korean tradition and they can maybe make it more attractive to the kind of audience that is interested in K-pop. So, for lack of a better term, I'm calling our third approach K-popifying tradition. So, one example of this is a group that was called Niji. They don't exist anymore. It was a group of traditional Korean performers who were recruited by the government and made into something like a girl group. And they performed on all the same shows that you normally see K-pop artists performing on, but they never really were able to strike a chord with audiences. And even though the people in the government that were supporting things like spending money on Meiji, those people felt that if young audiences saw these beautiful young women attractively playing these instruments on the same kind of TV programs that you see K-pop stars on, that this would then translate into people being interested in knowing more about tradition. As you can see in the video, or more accurately, as you can hear in the video, there's a lot of instrumentation that's coming through very strongly, and even musical techniques that are dominating the soundscape that are Western. And so, in fact, Niji was supposed to showcase the attractiveness of Korean traditional instruments, but it didn't actually do that if you listen.
Thank you. gathered a lot of the songs that I've been talking about in the last few minutes together on my YouTube channel within a playlist, which I call K-pop with Hints of Tradition. And it includes the songs that have visual tradition and also the songs that have oral tradition. So you can check that out.